Yeah, any repeat familiar names?
Second. We have a motion and a second to move public hearing 10 to when?
To July 5th, it looks like it's the first public.
To July 5th. We have a motion and a second. If there's no further discussion, please vote on the motion. That passes 4-0 with Commissioner Ramos being absent. Any other changes?
Mr. Chairman, I'd also like to move under new business number one, also to the first meeting in July, July 5th, the public hearing. It's under new business number one, it's the Mashburn.
We have a motion and a second. If there's no further discussion, vote on the motion. And that passes 4-0 with Commissioner Ramos being absent. Any other changes?
Mr. Chairman, I'd also like to move administrative hearing number two to the June 21st meeting. That is by request of the appellant. That's the Amelia Bay matter.
We have a motion and a second. If there's no further discussion, please vote on the motion. That passes 4-0 with Commissioner Ramos being absent. Any other changes?
I've got one under administrative hearings. Administrative one, CII. Submitted for actual business itself, local town, and moved to July 5th as well. Motion to administrative hearing one, CII, to July 5th.
Do you want to move?
As per their counsel.
Is it CII or C?
The CII is for the employee itself.
Oh, we're going to hear that?
If she's here, yes, it's just for the term of the actual facility, so. So I believe I'm saying that correctly.
Yes. Second.
We have a motion and a second. If there's no further discussion, please vote on the motion. And that passes 4-0 with Commissioner Ramos being absent. Any more changes?
Chairman, just clarification on one change that's made. The new business item one, I believe you postponed until July 5th to be, to go to a public hearing. I just want to make sure that that is the intention of the board and council.
Which one is that?
New business number one.
I think it would, I'm sure we go to new business or old business.
Would go back.
Do business in July or go to old business?
If we did, it was postponed or go to old business.
What was the motion?
It was to postpone it to July 5th, then go to old business.
So I heard you said, happy?
Yes, do you want to restate the motion or the?
Well.
Or you just?
Yes, sir. The motion would be to postpone item, new business number one, to the July 5th meeting where we will cut our old business out.
Thank you.
Need a second.
Need a second. I'll second that. If there's no further discussion, please vote on the motion. All those in favor, press the button. And that passes 4-0 with Commissioner Ramos being absent. Anything else? Yes. Well, you want to do that when we get to this?
We do, so get to that.
All right.
That's what I was just looking at.
Go ahead.
Well, part of voting was, so that I have to move it now. That's item. 2A. Item 2A, I would like to take off the consent agenda. Might get a new business item.
Do I hear a second?
Second.
We have a motion and a second. If there's no further discussion, please vote on the motion. And that passes 4-0 with Commissioner Ramos being absent.
Mr. Chairman, that becomes new business number two. With that now being new business number two, Mr. Chairman, I make a motion to postpone that until the Mr. Derrick, how's the June 12th work session? It's pretty busy.
It is.
I make a motion to postpone to the June 26th work session.
Is that for the purpose of further discussion and more information?
Yeah, there's been some additional information. I think that we need some additional discussion on it.
We have a motion and a second. If there's no further discussion, please vote on the motion. And that passes 4-0 with Commissioner Amos being absent. Any further changes?
Mr. Chairman, I'd just like to state on the previous public hearing number 10, which was moved to July 5th, that an ad will be running to comply with the zoning compliance act. So I just wanted to make that for the record.
Thank you.
Mr. Chairman, there's also here on administrative here at the moment a Mr. Caruso. This is Caruso. Today, when I leave it tonight, seeing as that's also in District 1, should we postpone this until July?
What is the item?
It's an administrative hearing for Fenneberg Lanes. Should we postpone that until the next, and that way the District 1 Commission is here in the applicant?
How does that work for you?
Well, that's just that's all.
Well, he's not.
Well, I don't see that.
So, Mr. Chairman, I make a motion to postpone item 1A9 to July 5th administrative hearings.
July 5th? Second.
We have a motion and a second. If there's no further discussion, please vote on the motion. And that passes 4-0 with Commissioner Evans being absent. Any more changes? If not, the Chair entertains a motion to adopt the agenda as amended.
Second.
We have a motion and a second. If there's no further discussion, please vote on the motion. That passes 4-0 with Commissioner Amos being absent. Announcements and reports. Are there any announcements or reports?
Yes, Mr. Chairman. Tonight I have invited a young man, Mason Moore, to give a speech to the board that I heard last month while attending the 8th grade award ceremony at Riverwatch Middle School. Mason, if you would, please come to the podium. Once Mason finishes his remarks, I would like to present a resolution to Mason in recognition of his leadership efforts.
I began my 8th grade year mostly interested in sports. Everything revolved around baseball, wrestling, and track. If you had told me I would be where I am right now, I would have said, no way, that is not. As I entered my school for the beginning of my final year at Riverwatch, an opportunity presented itself. Well, not exactly. My amazing guidance counselor, Ms. Endo, told me that I should run for vice president. This idea became an infection, as it now stayed in my mind for days. After many thoughts, I finally made up my mind that I would run. Throughout the election process, I had my doubts. I really did not believe that I would be elected, since I was going up against so many worthy opponents. It was not until the day before our school convention that I truly got the realization that me and my running mate could win. As we sat together with the other students running, my partner Olivia assured me that we would win. From there on out, I was thinking about what we were going to do as class president and vice president. Months later, we were on our way to GISC. This stands for Georgia Association of Student Councils. There was a theme for the convention called Set Sail on the Leadership, Explore, Dream, Discover. When we arrived, it was planned that I was to give a speech related to the theme in the speech contest. I was quite nervous, but also excited. This is the same speech I will be presenting to you today. To my surprise, this speech on leadership won the contest. I was so proud of the convention, but not of myself. I was proud of the other students on our student council for their commitment to leadership and making our school better. At the convention, our school became very popular. It was the first time we had ever attended the convention, so we did not expect very much recognition. However, Riverwatch got more than most schools. I felt our school earned it though, because we had worked so hard all year. Once I had received the award for my speech, I received another award. This is one that made me feel so humbled. I was declared GISC Middle School Member of the Year. I felt that it was not just earned by me, but earned by the rest of the students on the student council. Every year, GISC has a statewide service project. This year's was based on bowling coverage. I felt so connected because me and my running partner ran on the old bowling platform. After returning from the convention, we became focused on accomplishing more things than we had set out to do. We focused lots of our attention to the no bowling project. We accomplished much more than we had expected to. Many of our new beginnings for our school will continue to be pushed and worked for next year and years to come. Now school has ended, my term could be considered over. However, it lives on with the other students on the council who worked so hard this year. The Riverwatch Middle School Student Council is now on the GISC Executive Board. I worked so hard for it, and I feel like even though I accomplished so much this year, I do not deserve the credit. All the people who pushed me, my parents, friends, my school counselor, Ms. Endo, and of course, the council itself, have earned all the credit. As I move on to Lambert High School, I have big plans. It is hard to think I will not have the group I had this year to push me, but I realize that I will find a new goal. I will miss my middle school. However, I'm excited to move on to high school and bigger things. I plan to stay involved with sports, but most of all, I plan to stay involved with student leadership. I hope that staying committed to this will take me to big places beyond my imagination. I would like to take this moment to thank Commissioner Tam for inviting me today, and this is my speech on leadership. Leadership. It is defined as the ability to lead or influence others. A person might say, you show great leadership skills. Well, thanks, but the question is, what is meant by leadership? Leadership can be very widely defined. It is one of those things where it is what you make it. What it means to someone must be decided by them. I depict leadership in my own way, which may be very different from how others see it. A leader does not just walk around all tough like they own everybody. A leader is someone who lays low, under the radar, and goes the extra mile behind the scenes. That person leads by example, but not just doing, by doing, not just commanding. Several people have said to me, you don't do anything as our class president. These comments can sometimes get me down. However, when I think more deeply about it, I realize it's just because they don't see me ordering others around. I'm okay with them thinking this, because I know deep down that I'm leading with my actions when they are not looking. They don't see me getting up before dawn on Sunday morning to travel with my church youth group to feed the homeless. They don't know that I take time out to read to disabled children. It's the activities like these of serving others that I happily participate in. Not for the purpose of receiving grace from others, but to be able to share the blessings I receive from others. Martin Luther King Jr., arguably one of the greatest leaders of the 20th century, puts it best. A genuine leader is not a searcher for consensus, but a molder of consensus. King was not looking for recognition. He was fighting his cause for his followers and was the humblest of men. In addition, Martin Luther King Jr. had goals and dreams he had set for himself and for the people he led. One of the most nationally recognized speeches was given by King, called I Have a Dream. He explored the minds of citizens, touching them with his bravery. He discovered that he should never give up and that there is good in everyone. It is dreamers, visionaries, and leaders like this who are able to dramatically and permanently change the world. Yes, changing the world sounds impossible. However, it is the small acts of those silent leaders that change the world. I would love to follow in King's footsteps and positively alter the world. However, I know that it is my small, intentional actions of serving others that can positively impact individuals one at a time. I admit it's thrilling when you get publicly recognized for your actions. But the feelings that you receive are even greater when you carry out a small act of service that goes unnoticed. These are the ones that really make me happy. These are the ones that I believe make a great leader. As we set sail on the leadership, exploring, dreaming, and discovering, don't fear to step out and help those that are less fortunate with one small act of kindness at a time. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Mason. I have a resolution that I would like to read. A resolution by the Board of Commissioners of Forsyth County, Georgia. Whereas student leaders are a positive influence on their peers, showing good character and scholarship in and out of the classroom. And whereas Riverwatch Middle School recently graduated one of their own student leaders, Mason Lord, and whereas Mason Lord was an honor roll student, active in the Fellowship of Christian Athletes, competed in track, and was elected to serve as a school president for the 2011-2012 school year. And whereas the Georgia Association of Student Councils, GASC, presented Mason Lord the Middle School Member of the Year Award, and Mason was given the opportunity to present his speech on leadership at the GASC convention, which earned him first place recognition. And whereas Mason Lord will soon be entering Lambert High School, where he will continue to set the example and be an inspiration for all of his peers. Now, therefore, be it resolved that the Board of Commissioners of Forsyth County, Georgia, does hereby recognize and commend Mason Lord for his outstanding leadership and community involvement. Be it further resolved that a copy of this resolution be recorded in the official minute book of the Board of Commissioners, and that a copy of same be presented to Mason Lord. In testimony whereof, we have hereunto affixed the seal of the County of Forsyth, State of Georgia, and signatures of the members of the governing body thereof, given at Cumming, Georgia, the 7th day of June, 2012. Thank you, Mason.
Thank you.
Thank you, Mason. You're an inspiration to us all. Mr. Chairman.
Thank you. This brings us to public comments.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, members of the board. We would like to take a moment to review the meeting procedures. Please silence all cell phones and electronic devices. Please refrain from disrupting the meeting through general outbursts, applause, or comments. All comments shall be directed to the entire board and not to a particular commissioner. If you have documents for the commissioners, please provide those to the clerk. If fewer than seven copies are submitted, only one copy will be retained by the clerk as part of the permanent record. Those who wish to speak must sign up by completing a public comment or public hearing form available just outside this room. Information regarding specific requirements to address the board is listed at the podium. Please state that information prior to speaking. Per the county's broadcast policy, the county is not responsible for statements made during public meetings and does not warrant the accuracy of such statements. The public comments portion of the meeting is intended to allow speakers to make a verbal presentation to the board. The number of speakers is limited to 10. Speakers are selected on a first-come basis and will be heard in the order in which they signed up, with the exception that Forsyth County residents will be heard first, with non-county residents to follow until the allotted time has expired. Each speaker is limited to 3 minutes. The public comments portion is limited to 30 minutes. With respect to the public hearings portion of the meeting, each side, those in opposition and those in support, are allotted 10 minutes to speak. Each speaker is limited to 3 minutes. Mr. Chairman, there are no public comment speakers signed up this evening.
Thank you, Jody. Adoption of minutes. Is there a motion to adopt minutes for the regular meeting of May 7th?
Moved.
Second. We have a motion and a second. If there's any further discussion, please vote on the motion. That passes 4-2-0 with Commissioner Amos being absent. Consent agenda. Chair entertains a motion to adopt the consent agenda as modified. Oh, sorry. Chair entertains a motion to adopt the minutes of the work session and executive session May 22nd, 2012.
Second.
We have a motion and a second. If there's no further discussion, please vote on the motion. That passes 4-0 with Commissioner Reynolds being absent. Chair entertains a motion to adopt the minutes of the special call meeting May 24th, 2012.
Second.
We have a motion and a second. If there's no further discussion, please vote on the motion, which passes 4-0 with Commissioner Amos being absent. Now the consent agenda as amended.
Second.
We have a motion and a second. If there's no further discussion, please vote on the motion. That passes 4-0 with Commissioner Amos being absent. Public hearings. Number one.
This is Chairman members of the Board of Public Hearing Number 1, AL120565. This is located in Commission District Number 2. And the request is for approval of an alcohol license for Padlock LLC doing business as location at TAP. The name licensee is Michael J. Tattle. For an application to sell distilled spirits, malt beverages, and wine for consumption on the premises at the request of business located at 3590 Old Manor Road, Suite 209. All the information contained in the application is consistent with Ordinance 68, therefore a public hearing is warranted and recommended by staff. Thank you.
Tom? Chair would entertain a motion to open the public hearing.
So moved.
Second. We have a motion and a second. If there's no further discussion, please vote on the motion, which passes 4-0 with Commissioner Reynolds being absent. Is there anyone here to speak in favor of this application or license? Is there anyone here who wishes to speak in opposition to this license or application? I don't see anyone, so Chair entertains a motion to close the public hearing.
So moved. Second.
We have a motion and a second. If there's no further discussion, please vote on the motion. That passes 4-0 with Commissioner Amos being absent. District 2, I believe.
And Mr. Chairman, is there anyone here from a local kitchen in TAP? Anyone representing them this evening? Well, it's my understanding the application is in order, therefore, I will move to approve the application. The Padlock LLC doing business as local kitchen in TAP. Main licensee is Michael J. Patota. And the application is to sell distilled spirits, malt beverages, beer, and wine for consumption on the premises.
Second.
We have a motion and a second. If there's no further discussion, please vote on the motion. And that passes 4-0 with Commissioner Amos being absent. Item public hearing B. Tom?
Yes, item B, AL120566. This is located in Commission District Number 2. It's a request for an alcohol license for Mexicano Grill Inc. Doing business as Fresh Mexicano Grill. Name licensee is John J. Moreno. For an application to sell distilled spirits, malt beverages, and wine for consumption on the premises at a place of business located at 5430 Guinness Ferry Road, Suite 103. All the information contained in the application is consistent with Ordinance 68. Therefore, public hearing is warranted and recommended by staff.
Thank you, Tom. Chair entertains a motion to open the public hearing.
So moved.
Second. We have a motion and a second. If there's no further discussion, please vote on the motion. And that passes 4-0 with Commissioner Ames being absent. Is there anyone who wishes to speak in favor of this license? Is there anyone who wishes to speak in opposition? Chair entertains a motion to close the public hearing.
So moved.
Second. We have a motion and a second. If there's no further discussion, please vote on the motion. And that passes 4-0 with Commissioner Ames being absent. District 2.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Is anybody here with Mexicano Grill, Inc.? Yes, sir. Thank you for coming in this evening. I would encourage you to familiarize yourself with the Forsyth County Alcohol Code. Okay? It's my understanding that the application is in order. Therefore, I move to grant approval for Mexicano Grill, Inc. Doing business as Fresh Mexicano Grill. Name licensee is Jan J. Moreno. Application to sell distilled spirits, malt beverages, beer, and wine for consumption on the premises.
Second.
We have a motion and a second. If there's no further discussion, please follow the motion, which passes 4-0. Commissioner Ames being absent. Item C.
Yes. AL120567. This is located in Commission District Number 2. It's a approval of alcohol license for Rush Inc. LLC, DBA Liquor. Name licensee is Sonier. For an application to sell distilled spirits, malt beverages, and wine by the package at a place of business located at 3651 Peachtree Parkway, Suite 1. All the information contained in the application is consistent with Ordinance Number 68. Therefore, public hearing is warranted and recommended by staff.
Thank you. Chair entertains a motion to open the public hearing.
Second.
We have a motion and a second. If there's no further discussion, please vote on the motion. And that passes 4-0 with Commissioner Ames being absent. Is there anyone here wishing to speak in favor of this license? The licensee.
Mr. Chairman, Ethan Underwood, with Mr. Johnson, who represented the applicant. This mayor is here. We're happy to answer any questions that you have.
Thank you. Anyone else wishing to speak in favor? Is there anyone who wishes to speak in opposition? If there are no questions for Mr. Underwood, the chair entertains a motion to close the public hearing.
So moved.
We have a motion and a second. Please, if there's no discussion, vote on the motion. That passes 4-0 with Commissioner Ames being absent. District 2, Commissioner.
Yes, Mr. Chairman. Is there anyone here? Ethan, is your client here?
Yes, sir. He's here.
Here, on, I just ask that you familiarize yourself with the Forsyth County Alcohol Code. Okay? My understanding the application is in order, therefore I will make a motion to approve the application for Russian Inc. LLC doing business as liquor. Name licensee is Sonia Meter. Application is to sell distilled spirits, malt beverages, beer, and wine by the package.
Second.
We have a motion and a second. If there's no further discussion, please vote on the motion. That passes 4-0 with Commissioner Ames being absent. Item number two is the second reading of the Forsyth County Records Retention Ordinance.
Yes, Mr. Chairman. My name is Chris Hamilton, just for the record. I'm here pinch-hitting for Ken Gerard tonight, who's away. With an ACCG hearing representing the county's interest there. This is the second reading, as you said. It's intended to ensure that the county retains all of our county government records for those times and durations set forth in the schedules promulgated by the State Department of Archives. Presently, Forsyth County adheres to the 2005 records retention schedules. This modification is simply to ensure that we are in compliance with the 2010 records retention schedules. This being the second public hearing, the board is authorized to take action after the public hearing this evening.
Thank you. Chair entertains a motion to open the public hearing.
Approved. Second.
We have a motion and a second. If there's no further discussion, please vote on the motion. And that passes 4-0 with Commissioner Raymond being absent. Is there anyone here wishing to speak in favor of the proposed amendments to the workers' retention ordinance? Is there anyone wishing to speak in opposition? Not. Chair entertains a motion to close the public hearing.
So moved. Second.
We have a motion and a second. If there's no further discussion, please vote on the motion. And that passes 4-0 with Commissioner Amos being absent. Hold on 1 second. This was the first reading, was it not?
Second.
This is the second. We're on to item number 3. All right. Is there a motion regarding this item?
Mr. Chairman, I motion that we approve the amendments to Forsyth County Records Retention Ordinance, which is ordinance number 90, specifically to update to the 2010 records retention schedules promulgated by the Secretary of State Division of Archives and History, as presented by the county attorney.
Second.
We have a motion and a second. If there's no further discussion, please vote on the motion. And that passes 4-0 with Commissioner Amos being absent. Item number three was the first reading of modifications to the Forsyth County Alcohol Ordinance. This is the first reading. No action is required. And the second public hearing has been advertised for June 21st, I believe. County Attorney?
Yes, Mr. Chairman. This is a modification. What has happened in the past is the board has had a little discretion with regard to mandatory minimums on employees who sell alcohol. These proposed modifications were intended to streamline that process such that with respect to technical violations, a first violation of an employee's sales permit would result in a warning or suspension of the employee's alcohol sales permit for a period of up to 30 days, as determined by and in the discretion of the Director of Forsyth County Planning and Development, Community Development. This would allow the Director to either issue a warning or to impose a suspension for a period of up to 30 days. The second and third violations, even if involving a technical violation, would get back on the regular track of a hearing before the Board of Commissioners. Now, with respect to underage sales, which is a more serious offense, a first infraction by an employee would result in a magistrate court hearing with a minimum fine set forth in the ordinance. But it would also provide that within 30 days of a finding of adjudication or adjudication of guilt, the magistrate court, that an automatic 30-day suspension would commence unless that suspension is appealed by the employee. It's very likely that most employees would not appeal the mandatory 30-day suspension. Therefore, that would remove some of the burden from the Board of Commissioners. With respect to second and third offense, within 24 months, the normal administrative process would occur. This is for a first public hearing this evening. This ordinance cannot be adopted this evening, and a second public hearing will occur on June 21st. The legal ads for this will run in the Forsyth County News on Sunday, June 21st.
Thank you very much. Chair entertains a motion to open the public hearing on this item.
So moved.
Second. We have a motion and a second. If there's no further discussion, please vote on the motion. And that passes 4-0, Commissioner Amos being absent. Is there anyone wishing to speak in favor of this modification? Is there anyone wishing to speak in opposition to this modification? If not, the chair would entertain a motion to close the public hearing.
So moved. Second.
We have a motion and a second. If there's no further discussion, please vote on the motion. And that passes 4-0. Commissioner Amos.
Just a point of clarification. Did you say the next public hearing on this was going to be June 21st?
Correct. The ads are ran.
Okay.
No action. And we're on to item four. Any attorney?
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. This addresses what has been known as the happy hour ordinance. In Forsyth County, presently, there is no provision for a reduced sale of drinks. But this phrase happy hour has been somewhat difficult to interpret over the years. In addition, there has been some discussion that the inability to authorize a reduced price in alcohol of any type in the county was possibly placing Forsyth County alcohol vendors at a disadvantage. Basically, under our existing code, we do not allow any reduced price drinks of any kind. The new proposed language would start the way the existing provisions start. That is, that there's no alcohol vendor may serve discounted drinks or increase the volume of alcoholic beverages contained in the drink without proportionally increasing the price customarily charged for such a beverage. Customary charge meaning the price charged for that beverage during the same calendar week. However, with the new ordinance, if adopted, there will be exceptions. A vendor under this new rule may offer one category of discounted price alcoholic beverages, the categories being the beer, wine, or liquor, subject to the following requirements. One, the discount may only be offered for a single business day, which we are calling a discount day, during which time the discount shall apply uniformly to the selected category of beverages at all times they are open. Secondly, they have to prominently display the discounted drink so that enforcement personnel can identify it and that during that discount day. They are not able to switch between categories of alcohol during the discount day. The licensee can only reduce a price or a discount of a beverage for a particular brand of beverage within a category. In other words, not just a beer, but a, for example, Coors beer or a Budweiser beer. These discount days can be ongoing so long as the code is complied with. Now, one other thing I would like to mention before we move forward on this, and this may need to be brought up in an agenda, this was brought up in an agenda review. The question has been raised that this ordinance may not address two-for-one drinks. To the extent that someone comes in under a discount day that says I want to be able to purchase two-for-one beers, that, in our opinion, would not be under this new ordinance. In other words, and what I want to emphasize to the board, the purpose of this amendment would be to allow a price discount for a single drink.
Thank you.
I'd like to say a little something anyways. This was brought.
Should we open the public hearing? Oh,
do you want it as part of the public hearing?
Part of the public hearing is fine. It doesn't matter. This is a comment on the premise.
Go ahead.
This was brought forward to me by some of the restaurant business owners, not to create a happy hour or anything that encourages someone to drink more, but they were very concerned that if they didn't have a ability to offer a free glass of champagne on Mother's Day and such like this type of holidays, that people would cross over the county line and go to another business, thus losing business as well as the county losing tax revenue and such. So, this is one of the reasons why this is brought forward. We're not looking to do 2-for-1 drinks or happy hours or anything like that. It's just to allow them to have a little bit of leverage within their business to offer certain things on daily specials.
Thank you. Chair would entertain a motion to open the public hearing.
So moved.
Second. We have a motion and a second. If there's no further discussion, please vote on the motion. And that passes 4-0 with Commissioner Amos being absent. Is there anyone here this evening wishing to speak in favor of this modification? Is there anyone wishing to speak in opposition? If not, then the chair would entertain a motion to close the public hearing.
Second.
We have a motion and a second. If there's no further discussion, please vote on the motion. And that passes 4-0 with Commissioner Amos being absent. Let's see, so this was the first hearing, and there's no action required.
That's correct.
Todd, I do have a question for you. If I heard you right, you mentioned something, I think, like on Mother's Day, of three glasses of champagne or something. Do you have any concern about offering anything, any alcoholic beverage for free? Let's say that another Mother's Day, you know, everybody would like to do that, but, you know, at some other time saying beer is free from.
They were saying they can typically go find certain places where they can offer a single glass with, you know, to bring the family in. And they can't even do that. They're not allowed to even do that much. If they want to do any kind of special now, it has to be by the entire week. It can't be for that holiday or something. I don't think it will encourage a lot of drinking if they don't give a time frame that you're jammed in to try to get a bunch of drinking done in a certain time frame. It's mostly being designed for that single drink, or maybe they do give you, and here's another example they gave me when they were explaining it. Certainly this is not my fans bringing it forward. I don't mind doing so if it helps the businesses. But they're explaining to me in a way that somebody's going out, they have $30 to spend. They've got a $17 steak dinner, and they'd like to have a beer with that, you know, they have to tip and tax and stuff, or maybe like two beers with that before they head home. That would go over their budget, and if they had that option to offer the beers at $3 instead of $6 a piece on that one day, that they would frequent that restaurant and not cross over to one of the counties to get the specialists offered over there. That's also driving for them as well, so.
Okay, thank you. No action is required, so if there's no other discussion about this, let's go on to the next item, number 5, which is the modifications to the Forsyth County sign ordinance.
Yes, Mr. Chairman, members of the board, the sign ordinance number 74. Public hearing, this is the first reading of proposed changes to the sign ordinance. These changes were initiated through direction we received from the Board of Commissioners in March and May of this year at our sessions. There are 5 main changes I'll quickly run you through. The first you will see on page 5 of the draft ordinance. That's page number 5, not the fifth page of the document, but page number 5. And that is, there's an update, a change actually, to the definition of banner. Our existing definition of banner was in need of some improvement. It didn't even include a vinyl product, which is the most typical common product we see on a banner. So there are changes to that definition. The second area of change you'll see is on page 11 of the ordinance. This deals with non-conforming signs, and there are, I would say, 2 subsections of this work. The first is that it clarifies that a non-conforming sign cannot be enlarged or altered. It goes on to say that this does not include a content change. So the content of the change could always be updated, but enlarging or changing the sign itself, the structure would not be allowed. The second part of the work in this non-conforming section you'll see is that it allows the conversion of a non-conforming sign to switch over to automated changeable copy. These are the types of signs most commonly we see today that I have a digital face similar to a flat screen TV or more sophisticated models where they're controlled from within the outlet. The 3-hour rule would apply to these signs, and that would be the content could only change once every 3 hours, so you would not see scrolling or flashing content. The third change to the ordinance you'll see on page 12, and this again goes back and plays off the banner definition we just got done discussing, and that is that we are prohibiting a banner type face from a permanent sign. The fourth change was related to monument signs. This is on page 14 of the document. A monument sign on the proposed wording would need to be enclosed so you cannot see the internal structure of the sign. The fifth and final change is on the last page of the document I gave you as the chart. This was discussed at the last work session. It was brought up specifically related to churches, but it would apply to uses in addition to churches, and it allows limited internal lighting, which the ordinance defines as direct lighting, in residential districts for non-residential uses. Now that, in our sign ordinance, I want to clarify residential districts include agricultural districts as well. Those are the changes. This is the first hearing, so there's no action tonight. I'll be here answering any questions you have on the work. Thank you.
Thank you, Tom. Chair, we entertain a motion to open the public hearing.
So moved. Second.
We have a motion and a second. If there's no further discussion, please vote on the motion. And that passes 4-0 with Commissioner Amos being absent. Is there anyone here wishing to speak in favor of these modifications? Is there anyone here wishing to speak in opposition to these modifications? Not chair would entertain a motion to close the public hearing.
So moved. Second.
We have a motion and a second. If there's no further discussion, please vote on the motion. That passes 4-0 with Commissioner Amos being absent. Tom, I have a question for you. What I think the way you phrased it was this would allow internally lighted signs in residential areas for non-residential applications or buildings. It's close to what you said.
That's right. Yeah.
What's a non-residential application other than a church?
It could be a clubhouse, a lodge, a school. Those are the most common. I'd say after that, you get to some really obscure stuff that would be unlikely to come up.
Tom, would you address the provision that we added in there about the streets that prohibits them? It's not in any residential. It's only allowed on what type of minor major arterials and collector streets. So if
that's
not allowed in a subdivision or even on anything other than those collector minor or major arterials. Is that right, Tom?
That's accurate. It limits these signs in two ways. One, what you just mentioned was that they're limited to the larger, more significant streets with heavier traffic volume, larger right-of-way. Streets that more typically have a non-residential look and feel to them. It also prohibits electronic message boards and automated changeable copy. So this product really falls between what we have today. Today we have typical residential provisions that are relatively strict, and we have our commercial provisions. What I heard from the Board of Commissioners was, let's find something that falls in the middle and not take it all away. And those two limitations are what we attempted to propose to achieve that.
Thank you. Since this is a first reading, no action is required. Unless somebody objects, I suggest we go on to item six. Tom.
Sharon Farrow, senior planner, so I handle item six.
Good evening. The addendum request is to amend the text of the UDC regarding Chapter 16 supplemental regulations for specific uses. The Planning Commission held their first public hearing on March 27th and again on April 24th. Not providing a recommendation. The purpose of the text amendment is to refine the existing code regarding minimum standards for the development of accessory structures within residential districts. This does not apply to agricultural districts. And to add new language to provide some minimum design criteria for an accessory structure to be considered attached to the principal building. I attempted to make some graphics here to just kind of walk through what we believe to be the issue. The little box in the bottom of the screen would be the primary home, a large building in back, too large or not meeting the code in 16. So the attachment is made so that they could basically claim it to be a principal structure, thereby not having to deal with conditional use permit if they convert it to living space, and then also not they don't have to worry about the size of the accessory structure. And this is all provided in Table 16-2 that we work with daily. The second sketch, say, is this is what the code allows for. If you're on less than an acre, you have a 2,200 square foot finished space, you can build up to 1,000 square feet or 60% of the finished space. So it's a fairly large accessory structure, and that is allowed by our code on a lot less than 1 acre. The next sketch is our third category. If it's 1 to 3 acres, we typically don't have any issues with the folks that have the larger size parcels. They can go 60% of the finished base or up to 1,000 square feet. And this is above even any garage that they may have in the primary home. And the next is 3+ acres. Again, we don't have many issues with these folks. They have a lot of land. And they can go up to 90% of their finished space. So if you have 2,200 square feet of finished space, you can have almost a 2,000 square foot accessory building, again, above and beyond what you may have in your primary garage. So what we are attempted to do, and this started several months back, we attempted to address the issue of the accessory structures going up and exceeding the limits and the purposes of accessory structures. So that is the changes in your agenda packet. Additionally, the code does provide for attached apartments throughout all the zoning districts. You can attach an apartment, a minimum of 400 and a 1,000, up to 1,000 square feet, provided it is attached to the principal building. And that is allowed in all of the residential sections, with the exception of Res 6 and Res 4. So what we're proposing is basically the attachment language and also clarify some other language that we deal with every day regarding the issue of the accessory structure. And that is it. It is in also both sections, the accessory structures in residential districts, and then it repeats itself in the accessory apartments attached language, make it a little bit easier for staff.
Thank you very much. The chair would entertain a motion to open the public hearing on this item.
So moved.
We have a motion and a second. If there's no further discussion, please vote on the motion. And that passes 4-0 with Commissioner Ames being absent. Is there anyone wishing to speak in favor of this recommendation? Is there anyone wishing to speak in opposition?
Chairman Ethan Underwood, I'm coming to you on behalf as a citizen of Forsyth County, asking you to not pass this. I'm afraid what we're doing is we are crossing into the realm of regulating what the shape of the building is.
Let me show you a little illustration.
Under the draft that's been presented to you, this is okay. If you come in with a building permit, you say at one time, I want a primary structure with a walkway, and let's say in a garage. If I come in at one time, that's fine. But we're saying it's morally acceptable. An impermissible configuration would be if you built the same primary structure, let's say you didn't have enough cash, 3 to 5 years later, you decide, you know what, we've got to find out enough money, we're going to put a garage on here. So let's put the accessory structure on here. Let's connect. You can't do that under this code without applying for a variance. Yet we're dealing with the exact same structure and configuration. We're just saying that the timing somehow makes this worthy of a law that requires us to get a variance. Now, let's be candid about how you get variances too. The problem with the variance of this sort, how do you say, I have a hardship, I really need a walkway behind my structure, I don't like to get wet? Is that a legitimate variance that you, the Board of Appeals, can weigh? That's not what's going to happen. What's going to happen is somebody's going to come in here and ask them for it, and you're going to say, well, are the neighbors upset about it? If they're not, you can have variance. And if the neighbors are upset about it, we're not sure you can have variance. You know, that is an arbitrary standard. And that's not how we're supposed to be dealing with our zoning ordinance. And I actually had an interesting trip. I got the opportunity this last week to take my son to Washington, D.C. And unfortunately, I never get away from work because we went and visited Mount Vernon. And the way my mind works is when I'm looking at this, all I can think of is, we couldn't get this in Forsyth County. I have to get a variance to this. Look at these horrible breezeways that we have between the accessory buildings on Mount Vernon and the primary structure. Folks, I admire you for what you do. This is a difficult job, but I wanted to ask you to remember that you are not an HOA board. If people want to live in a subdivision that says, here's what color my house has got to be, here's how tall my grass is going to be, here's how long my breezeway has to be, then go and get in a private agreement with the covenant. But conversely, there are folks who live in areas that have no covenants, and therefore, they ought not be burdened with this. Y'all are, again, you're not an HOA board, you're the government. And when you're saying we're going to apply a rule to affect everybody in the county. Now, I guess also, as I say to the Planning Commission, these things don't happen in a vacuum. The issues come up because of two incidences. Both those incidences had to do with a permit was issued by the county. It was a mistake, but permits were issued. And we had neighbors that came up and said, make them tear it down, make them tear it down. And instead of having to tear it down, I said, okay, we'll connect the breezeway. Both of these situations had no covenants on the property. So we're not dealing with something that's going to happen in Marl Springs or in Polo. They have their own mechanisms. But, gentlemen, as I said, the zoning power is meant to prevent nuisances. It's not meant to make this board into an HOA. And with all respect for the request that you don't approve this change. Thank you.
Houston, can I ask you a question?
Yes, sir.
I've also been to this place. Can you tell me approximately how many acres this sits on?
Well, it's over 3 acres. So for South County, we say you don't have, lives up to 90% of the principal structure. We still have to get a variance even on Mount Vernon.
This was built by and on the largest piece of property in the United States owned by a private citizen when it was built.
Okay. I agree, sir. But at some point, we have to let people. If people want to restrict property, that's fine. That's what private covenants are for. Let's just do it to our heart's content. But if people want to live with those covenants, we can't police that constantly. Thank you.
I think that Mr. Underwood makes perfect sense on this one. I don't know if you agree with everything he says, but I can't believe that a five-member board of Republicans in the second most conservative county in this nation, in a time when we've got things to worry about of great importance, such as budget, critical services, and things of that nature, that we're sitting here even discussing how are we going to limit the length and width of a hallway, a foyer or a hallway. We're going to limit the width to 6 feet by 8 feet by 16 feet. I would echo Mr. Underwood. I hope that this board will vote this down. I understand that there's a couple of issues in the county that have had problems, but we do have HOAs to address this where people do make a choice to live in a restricted community where the colors and lengths and shapes and materials are limited. But to make a countywide law that governs the shape of a foyer or hallway is absurd. Thank you.
Okay, anyone else? Let's see, I believe I was at those in favor, was I not?
Yes, sir.
No, in opposition. We have somebody who else would like to speak. Do we want to hear him or do we want to,
yeah,
without exception?
5 minutes.
If you'd like to speak, please come forward.
Chairman, Commissioners, my name is Chester Kumarski. I reside in this county for about 29 years. To address this issue, I think the reason that this came up for the changes in the UDC is not really to control any designs. I think it's to control what structures and how much structures you need to put on a parcel of land. You know, the example that was given was wonderful. That's a huge parcel of land. You know, do what you want. But when you're working with a half acre or slightly larger parcel of land, well, how much impervious area do you want to put on there? In one of these cases, you know, they say that all the permits were issued. That's not really true. Eventually, permits were issued out. And even with all the structures that were put on that particular parcel, required third-party inspectors. And hence, why I spoke against having third-party inspectors, because they're not really concerned about the county. They're concerned about their particular welfare. To go back to this same parcel of land, the way it all kind of came about was maybe possibly some miscommunications, and maybe there was some lack of due diligence on the planning department at that time. But at least this puts into play some controls that allows you to make good decisions. Otherwise, you have nothing, and this will continue on. So I'm really asking you that you put these controls into place. Incidentally, I'm a great and wonderful Republican here too. So I ask you to protect your citizens, put something into place. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Kaminsky. Mr. Kaminsky. So you are in favor of this, not in opposition?
Yes.
Okay. Thank you.
Not in opposition. I do apologize. I wasn't really ready when you asked us about the.
And in all due respect, I know that there's been some issues in your neighborhood, particularly this year
there
with your next door neighbor.
Right.
But the facts, as you have just reiterated, there were potentially some errors by staff. There is potentially a resident that did not follow the rules. If that's the case, how is creating another rule that somebody doesn't follow and is going to penalize and restrict the rest of the county? And that we're going to have to monitor the width and height of hallways. I can't say that enough, hallways and foyers. I understand there's a problem next door to you, that restricting the other 180,000 people that live in this county that own their land and have the right to do what they want with it, restricting them does not solve your problem. And it doesn't solve any problem because the people didn't follow the rule in the first place, and there may have been some errors made. This doesn't fix that. I understand there's a problem, and I'm sympathetic to that. But again, I cannot support, and I would ask this board not to support, more legislation and more rules, especially something that is addressing a hallway.
Mr. Bell, you're addressing the size of this foyer hallway that makes the connection. I'm addressing the actual connection in itself, that needs to be limited. You know, you've got, I'm sure that if you went throughout this county, you're going to see accessory structures on probably a lot of other lots and parcels. I'm looking at, again, different individuals putting in accessory structures on their property, and then in order to circumvent any other regulations or rules, they go ahead and they just simply connect it. I'm not looking at how wide this foyer is or how tall or whether it's 8 feet or 9 feet or 10 feet. I'm looking at what the distances are, because some of these things can get to be plain out and ugly. So
focus on the
connection of it, because then the accessory structure goes away.
Respectfully, it's not the place of government to regulate what is pretty or ugly.
And why do we have a sign ordinance?
I agree with the commissioner. And I'm one of the very odd people on this board that I don't believe we should tell anybody what to do with their property. I think somebody should be able to use 100% of what they bought and paid for and pay taxes on. I don't support them.
So your feeling is that if you create 100% concrete impervious area on every lot in this county, that's okay with you? Where's all the water going to help you? Where's it going to run out?
That is a hypothetical. That is a
it's not hypothetical. If you go on this one situation, you will see that there is 90-some% impervious area that's there. Water runs off to Lake Lanier, not clean water.
I understand that, but what I'm telling you is I don't believe that 100% of the parcels in this county would immediately call the paving contractors and have them pave 100% of their property. There's one issue, maybe two, in every parcel in this county, and as I said before on another issue, since the 1800s, we're talking about one or two issues. And to go to the trouble and expense that we've gone to so far is ridiculous. To think that the government is going to legislate the width and height of a hallway is ridiculous. To think that a government is going to regulate what some people may consider unattractive is ridiculous. And I'm sorry, I know you have a problem, but that is not a problem that's addressed by a UDC change that that affects every other landowner in this county. I'm sorry. I'm happy to try to ever help you solve your problem. I understand there's a problem. I'm sympathetic to that. But this is not the right answer. I'm sorry.
Well, then I respectfully ask the rest of the commissioners then to take a look at the situation that was there, put some controls in place, something that's there, or at least the guidelines that are there, so that, you know, it doesn't happen to other people. You got two, it doesn't matter, you know, I've been in this county a long time. I think something needs to be put into place.
I respect that, and I hope you understand that I'm not unsympathetic to your particular problem.
In the interest of time, I would propose that we move this item to the June 26th work session.
I don't know if there's any more discussion in the that we've done in the long term.
Sorry.
We need to close it.
Oh, I'm sorry.
Anyone else wishing to speak about this item? Is there a motion to close the public hearing?
Second.
We have a motion to second. If there's no further discussion, please vote on the motion. And that passes 4-0 with Commissioner Amos being absent.
Positive move will be postponed this to the June 26th work session for further discussion.
I'll second that. We have a motion and a second. If there's no further discussion, we'll vote on the motion. And that passes 3-1 with Commissioner Amos being absent. Item number 7, Director of Planning and Community Development.
Yes, hearing number 7, V8120022, Massive Companies LLC. This is located in Commission District number 2, and it's a public hearing regarding the request for variances to Forsyth County Unified Development Code Table 11.2B to allow lots number 12, number 13, 18, number 19, and number 20 in the Gables at Stony Point subdivision to have front yard setbacks of 20 feet instead of the required 30. The property is located in the Gables at Stony Point subdivision with lots 12, 13, 18, 19, and 20.
Thank you, Tom. Chair would entertain a motion to open the public hearing.
So moved.
So we have a motion and a second. If there's no further discussion, please vote on the motion. And that passes 4-0 with Mr. Ames being absent. Is there anyone wishing to speak in favor of this hearing?
Good evening. My name is Johnny Santander, 3525 Montville Crossing, Cumming, Georgia. And I'm one of the owners of Magnolia Residential. And developer of the Gables at Stony Point, as well as a builder in that neighborhood. SR Homes is the applicant for this variance, and they are the other builder alongside Magnolia in the neighborhood. And we are here to request a 10-foot front setback so that we could slide the homes forward 10 feet on these five lots to create more distance to the back of the yard, to the back of the home, to the stream buffer, and some severe topo that exists on the back of these lots. I have some pictures I wanted to show you.
Do you have a, go ahead.
This picture is of one of the homes that have already been constructed along these line of lots that did not have a variance. The retaining wall that you see there is holding up their backyard
Immediately following the retaining wall, as you see, it slopes down considerably down to what is a string buffer down there. And what we're trying to do is mitigate this from happening along these other lots by sliding the home forward 10 feet. It would have greatly helped this situation, creating a more desirable backyard for the homeowner, as well as providing some protection to the stream buffer and so forth that exists towards the rear of these homes. Incidentally, the UDC RS3 is 25 minimum front yard setbacks. The gables was platted for 30. So in actuality, what we're requesting is 5 feet to the actual UDC, but because it was platted at 30, it's a 10-foot request. I think that they would not provide any, negate the intent of the UDC, would keep the consistency of the neighborhood. There have been other variances for the same reason granted with the Zoning Board of Appeals. It's been onesies and twosies. We decided as construction has picked up, rather than continuing the space, that we would present it for. These are the remaining lots in the neighborhood at phase one that would require this setback so that we can build the desirable product. And incidentally, prior to even posting the public notice signs, I spoke with, I emailed all the residents of the neighborhood to let them know, as well as some neighboring residents to our community, so that they were aware of what was going on as well.
Okay, I'm going to have a series of questions for you.
Sure.
It'd be a little hard, but just bear with me. It's trying to hold against you. When I look at your bank behind that retaining wall, I see probably a 2-1 slope at best in some areas. I see footsteps in there, which show me that that was compacted because you probably couldn't get a machine on a steep slope like that. In your favor, if we give you this, will you be able to gain the 3-1 slope you need to put a machine on and compact that correctly?
Yes, our intent is actually to avoid having to do retaining wall at all. We don't want to have to do that. Obviously, those were compacted per code when they were built. This is not one of the homes that I built in here, so I can't speak to the level of halls involved, but I know that everything was done as per code and inspected.
You see the footprints in that dirt on the top there now?
Yes, those are mine, by the way, trying to take the picture to capture.
And you may have had to pack, and I don't know if there's extra dirt, a little bit extra afterwards or so, but you can see the first 10 feet of slope dropping down.
Yeah. And what we're trying to do is, in fact, I've got other pictures, but they just kind of show the same thing. It's more of an overview where you see from that guardrail to the steps that come off the deck is maybe 4 feet. I mean, and then you've got the guardrail, and then you've got that, and then going forward. I actually have, I think this will help, the home next to this one, which is currently under construction. This is the lot next door. Now, at the extreme left of the picture, you can start to capture the rear extreme of the footing. But you can see it's going to have a similar situation. And then the one I showed prior was lot 14. This is lot 15. And then you go on from there. 16 and 17 have been dealt with on a previous one-off variance application. The rest of them would be captured on this application.
And what's the number of units that are approved for this if you don't get this variance, and how many units will you build if you do get this variance?
I'm sorry?
What's the number of units that you will build or that are in this development if you do not get this variance? Question one. And number two, what's the number that you will build if you do get the variance?
Well, I think right now we're currently building in phase one. This would be 5 lots that we propose to build. I would say that we would likely continue to build on them regardless the variance, but it would create a situation like what we're talking about here. I don't know that because we didn't get the variance that homes would not be constructed on those sites.
So your expectation is it's the same number, you're not ending up with additional homes?
No, sir. No, I see your question. No, it's those are five homes on five lots, and we would build them regardless, but we're trying to build the same homes as what we've started in the neighborhood, not have to go to any different product, and yet at the same time mitigate the issues at the rear of these lots. And these would be the last of, these would capture all of the lots in phase one that have this issue. The 10 feet minimum that were the 10 feet variance that we're going for is, I would feel, the minimum requirement to get at the result that we want to get at.
Any more questions? Does anyone else wish to speak in favor? Does anyone wish to speak in opposition? If not, Chair would entertain a motion to close the public hearing.
So moved. Second.
We have a motion and a second. If there's no further discussion, please vote on the motion. That passes 4-0 with Commissioner Amos being absent. District 2.
Okay. So we're clear, we're talking about five lots and a setback, front yard setback of 5 feet.
That's 10 feet. 10 because it was platted. Am I allowed to speak?
Yeah, it's platted for 30.
Yeah, it's
platted,
exactly.
Okay. All right. And that pulls you further away from that screen of the knife there?
Correct. Actually, on lots 12 and 13, if you have a plat, you can see an extreme situation caused by the impervious surface setback at the rear 12 and 13, and then it comes back around to 18 and 19. But it's a combination of the screen buffer and the topography that we're trying to address all at once.
Now, please accept this in the spirit it's offered. However, I would hate to grant this only to find out that you built all the way to a 2-to-1 slope anyway. Is there any way we know that you're not going to run these houses all the way back to the stream, or the lot back to the stream?
There's a rear build line, and then there's also the impervious setbacks. What we would do is, the slope that exists is already there. We did not create the slope. What we're trying to do is, you know, instead of having to build the home so the back of the basement is here, so that we can slide it forward and get away from the slope. The slope that you see there just kind of runs on to the existing slope that was developed out there when that neighborhood was created.
Whether you built the slope or not, when you go for a CO, you do understand they look at that.
Well, they absolutely
do. And if they truly feel that you don't have your correct 3-to-1 slope, they're not going to ask whether you built it or not.
Understood.
Okay.
Fair enough. Understood.
So I'm taking it to mean you're not going to change the dimensions of the units to come out the back an extra 5 or 10 feet and end up with the same rear view that you would if we had granted the variance.
I see your point. Yes, sir. I'm looking to build the same product, just moving forward and create. The objective here is to create distance away from this situation, not to be able to encroach further or build a bigger product.
These are interior lots.
No, sir, exterior lots.
I don't know if that matters a lot because it's just going to bring it further from the exterior.
Yeah, that's what I was.
I mean, right. I'm finding it hard to find a downside that would bring this area.
Right. By the way, I should pull them closer into the light neighborhood.
Yes, I'm pulling forward towards the street and away from the.
Okay. I move that we grant variance to UDC table 11.2B to allow lots 12, 13, 18, 19, and 20 only in the Hables and Stony Point subdivision in front yards setback of 20 feet, VA 120022.
We have a motion and a second. If there's no further discussion, please vote on the motion. And that passes 4-0 with Commissioner Amos being absent. Item number 8.
It's public hearing number 8AZ120007. This is an amendment of zoning conditions and located in Commissioner District Number 2. The public hearing is for Chairman Ragsdale regarding the amendment of condition number 16, placed on zoning application 3450. Condition is shown on your screen. The property is located on the north side of Majors Road, approximately 275 feet southeast of the intersection of Majors Road Drive. It is on CBD by the Board of Commissioners on December 20th, 2007.
Thank you. Chair will entertain a motion to open the public hearing.
So moved. Second.
We have a motion and a second. If there's no further discussion, please vote on the motion. And that passes 4-0 with Commissioner Amos being absent. Is there anyone wishing to speak in favor of this request?
Good evening, Commissioners. Name is Alan Moes, and I'm speaking on behalf of the ownership group of the assisted living community. And I just wanted to establish that the current license by the state is for the community to operate 54 beds, and this request is simply to amend to comply with the state license. We do not plan on any construction. An example of why we would want this to be available with a 48-unit community would be if we have a spouse that wants to live with their spouse in the room, we can have two beds in that room. Currently, we're only allowed to have one bed in each room.
So how many rooms do you have?
48.
How many rooms do you want the kitchen to have?
48.
So you're not adding rooms, you just want
correct
to see if you can have
bed. Correct.
Do you have any idea why this was originally written in reference to the number of beds as opposed to the number of bedrooms or rooms or something?
I do not. I believe I was told that this was probably an error either on our part or on the part of the person filing the language.
I think we asked them for a number of beds. That was pretty much standard protocol.
Apparently, the state measures the 5 beds too, right?
Yes, sir. Which is why I think we're going to have a license for
okay. Any other questions? Anyone else wishing to speak in favor? Is anyone here wishing to speak in opposition to this request? Chair would entertain a motion to close the public hearing.
So moved.
Second. We have a motion and a second. If there's no discussion, please vote on the motion. And that passes 4-0 with Commissioner Ames being absent. Anyone have a motion?
Yes, Mr. Chairman, I move that it's District 2 that we grant the request by Chairman Ragsdale to amend the zoning condition number 16. To change the wording to allow from 48 beds to 54 beds.
Second.
We have a motion and a second. If there's no further discussion, please vote on the motion. And that passes 4-0 with Commissioner Ames in absence. Item 9.
SP110004, Rochester and Associates, Inc. This is located in Commission District Number 5. The applicant's request is sketch by approval to develop 13 residential lots on 71.07 acres of property zoned R2R. The property is located on the west side of Pilgrim Mill Road at the intersection of Crescent Drive and on the north side of Electra Lane.
Thank you, Tom. Chair would entertain a motion to open the public hearing.
Second.
We have a motion and a second. If there's no further discussion, please vote on the motion. And And that passes 4-0 with Commissioner Anderson being absent. Is there anyone here wishing to speak in favor of this request?
Good evening. Patrick Scott, Rochester Associates, 425 Lewis Street, Gainesville, Georgia. We're here tonight on behalf of the Family Partnership Group, Les Loch Ness Investments. The Rue family has been in ownership of this property since before the lake had been constructed. Their ownership goes back to even when Footer Mill Road was a dirt road. So they have been in ownership for quite some time. The property is approximately 71 acres. It's located on Footer Mill Road in Exeter Lane. It has a lot of frontage against Lake Lanier. We have submitted a request for a sketch plat approval to subdivide the property into 13 lots, ranging from 2.8 acres to 8.5 acres. The lots will access, one of the lots will access off of Pilgrim Mill Road, with one of the lots accessing off of Exeter Lane. 13 lots will have access on Lake Lanier. Lot number 11, as you can see on our plan, the Rue family actually has a residence on this property, and their intent is to retain ownership of lot number 11 and the residence. The current residence currently has an existing dock that will stay as part of lot number 11. We have submitted our application to the Corps of Engineers and have been approved for a 12-slip community dock, with the intent that each of the additional lots would get ownership if they so choose one of the slips. We've also created on lot number 11 a small parking area for community parking. This area will be limited to only availability to the additional 12 lots in the development. We're proposing 12 parking spaces there, and it will be limited to only access for the boat slip. No additional amenity improvements are intended for the site at this time. Also, if you'll notice, there is a 20-foot access easement that traverses through the center of the property. It serves access to three residents on the west side of the property between my client's property and Lake Lanier. The intent of my client is to continue to work with those residents to basically cause the least amount of disturbance through this development and not prohibit their access at all. As you can see, we have one lot in particular that will probably require for a driveway crossing, which would be lot number 9, in order to provide access. Lot number 8, there is opportunity for a house to be built up near Pilgrim Mill Road that would not require access for the driveway across there. And then obviously lot number 7, even though a portion of the easement extends across that lot, there's not ample opportunity for residents to be built there without having interference with that easement. Basically our client has, we feel like, is making a lot of concessions. Obviously, given the zoning in that area and a lot of the adjacent property owners, and I think I actually have a CV of that. That is our property there, basically colored in orange. As you can see, this property is essentially surrounded on all sides by other developments with a much higher density. Obviously, the 13 lots on 71 acres is a very, very low density given the zoning and of the other uses in the property. We're basically asking tonight that you accept our request for a sketch plan to subdivide the property with minimum restrictions on my client. I'd like to reserve the rest of my time for any rebuttal, if any, or any questions.
Thank you. Anyone else wish to speak in favor? Anyone wish to speak in opposition to this request?
Minimum house of 2,500 square feet, heated surface.
The reason why I'm asking that for is I'm afraid that if we can put a trailer in there, my value of my property will be totally downgraded. If we have 11 trailers there, that would be devastating. If they subdivide this and make it into smaller properties, or cut it into smaller properties, the value of my house and my other people that live there will totally go down the drain. So I ask for this amendment that 2,500 square feet heated surface minimum.
Tom, could you address that about mobile homes?
The agenda is shown up as a property zone R2R, and a manufactured home is prohibited in R2R.
Is that totally sure that the mobile homes are not allowed?
How about the minimum square footage of 2,500?
Okay, what was the UDC spell?
$1,100 square feet
minimum. What is it?
Yes.
That equals at the chicken school, 1,000 square feet. And so I would ask for an increase in size.
Thank you.
Mr. Brown, I have on single family home detached homes, can you name anywhere, I guess, in the last 3 or 4 years, that built homes had a minimum of 1,100 square feet?
That'd be very uncommon.
Why don't we just do this real quick?
Can I ask?
Not that I can think of off the top of my head.
What is your intent right now? Certainly, I mean, these are big lots. It's valuable lots on the lake. You don't have to build 1,100 square foot homes, I don't believe. What is your intent?
But for one thing that we would like to have. I'm Brian Rochester with Rochester & Associates, and one of the things we would like is the flexibility. Obviously, if you look around this, we can ask for density comparable of about 7 times what we're asking for. So I think our client's going well above and beyond. This is a very unique piece of property, and what we need flexibility is there may be a primary residence that's built there that's larger than that, but on a 7 or 8 acre lot, if they wanted to build a smaller caretaker residence or something else like that, we would like some flexibility to be able to build those residences on there.
That might be addressed as an accessory structure type of hallways. We don't have hallways in the hallways. You're not going to put hallways in that
thing. No, sir. There'll be no
hallways. No, it has to.
We do allow you to bury streams, though, because you can do anything you want with your property.
Tom, is it, would they come under an accessory structure type?
It would be permitted as an accessory structure. It would actually prohibit 2 primary structures on a residential lot. So it has to be 1 primary. One accessory, and accessory could have smaller size.
Can it be lifted in the accessory structure?
Yes.
Let's continue on.
Okay, anyone else wishing to speak in favor or in opposition? In opposition, okay.
Commissioners, I'm Jim Callison, 4346 Building Mill Road. We've lived there for 16 years. We're next to part of this property. I'll be very grateful if you save time for a rebuttal and other neighbors to speak, but I wish. We're concerned about one lot, lot number 8, and that particular lot, the front of our house is about 90 to 100 feet from the property line, and the front of our house faces the back of that lot and the back of that house where it will be built. The land slopes down from that lot through our front yard to our front door. We're concerned if that lot were graded all the way to the property line, that there would be some runoff when it rains that would wash down into our front yard and in our front door. And we think this is unusual again because in this case we would be, the front of one house would be looking at the back of another house, which is normally not the way it is. Normally houses are back to back. We we're just concerned too if that lot was cleared all the way to the property line, a house was built there. We all, I think, including me, put things in our backyards that we wouldn't necessarily put in our front yards. Dog bins, junk piles, tool sheds, trampolines, trash cans, all kind of things. And we just feel for those two concerns, those two issues, that it could decrease our property values if there was runoff coming from that lot onto our front yard especially. And also, again, if we were looking from the front of our house to the back of another house right there at the property line or a cleared area there. So we're requesting the commission consider an undisturbed buffer on the back of that one lot only as a condition for this approval. We're not asking for buffers on all the lots. We're not asking for any restrictions on any other restrictions on this lot. We would just like an undisturbed buffer there to protect our property values.
Thank you. Anyone address that?
We certainly are open to working. Obviously, we have worked very hard going through this, but we had a large group of people that initially came out. Once they understood what could be developed there and what we are proposing there, that greatly went away. We already have a 50-foot building setback off of his property anyway. So we feel like that, and obviously, when you're on the lake, I don't know that a lot of people go out there and necessarily want to clear cut everything down there, but we sure would not want to put an undisturbed buffer between a residence on the lake and the Corps of Engineers property line. If nothing else, they like the ability to be able to clear underbrush or do some other things in the canopy, potentially limb the trees up, just an open view shed. So a complete undisturbed buffer, I think, is very excessive on our client that has already gone, and I would consider well above and beyond. Again, if you look at the plat of what's been developed all the way around us, he's not asking for anything near what he could have come in here and asked for. So I think with that in mind, Commissioner Bell, we would ask that, you know, we can work to try to be good neighbors. We want to do that. We're not arguing 50-foot setback, that's fine. But to say an undisturbed buffer on Lake Lanier, I can't name any other place where we've had that around, especially on a 6 or 7 acre lot, is what we're talking about.
Tom, is there, there's some standards that undisturbed buffer during construction and development is removed, that it has to be replanted to certain standards. Can you maybe help us understand, does an undisturbed buffer mean that nothing can be cleaned out, or can underbrush be cleaned out? Is there some way we could?
We would be limiting it to, if a neighborhood, the property owner calls, so they want to remove some poison ivy, poison oak, because we've already signed off on all that. We just want to go in there though and basically wipe out all undergrowth and put down mulch. That's, no, we're not going to sign off on that.
You know, here's what I would like to do, Mr. Chairman, if you don't mind, with that type of discussion, with what you've said, I would agree that you would not want to have all of the underbrush and vines and all that stuff blocking the view. I'd like to ask Mr. Chairman if we could just delay this vote tonight for a few minutes, perhaps go on to the next item, ask them if they could go out and perhaps come to an agreement on what type of buffer. Maybe we talk about specimen trees and things like that, but you can put out underbrush, and maybe we're going to get this done tonight. If you the two of you could go out, or you and your client, maybe.
I'm going to add one more note to that. When I'm on the scale on this, the backside of the middle one, a lot number 8, to where potential water can come to, not the core line, potential where shows water sits, is about 500 feet. So I'm not sure how 50 feet. It's about 500 feet from lot number 8, to the back of the middle one here, to the potential of water to be for here is 500 feet. So I don't see how a little 50 feet or 25 foot buffer would make a difference of the other 450 to 475 feet.
We're not asking that we want to come in and wipe it out. Would just like the ability to, when you say an undisturbed buffer, I think on a 6 acre lot, that's pretty excessive.
I think that we can probably, based on what you've said and what I think quickly, if you want. Because you talk about maybe living them up a little bit.
That's right.
Yeah, I think maybe some of that could be.
Okay.
That work before we postpone it or anything.
Right.
I think it'd be a good opportunity. I think you probably come to.
Result.
I think.
And try to keep in mind what realistically the main structure could be for square footage, and keep in mind that Mr. Brown told you that secondary
right.
Still be,
I think
okay.
that issue, I think we're, we can, I think that one's less of a concern to me, I think, knowing that we can build the secondary structure.
Thank you.
I don't think.
Is this about you?
I would like to, since this has come up again, just to clarify, a detached accessory apartment will require a conditional use permit as well. Don't want to set you down the wrong path here.
I would like to talk briefly, though, before anything goes to some other conversation, about the public dock, coastal dock. First of all, Tom, I assume that would be considered an acceptable use in a residential or an R2R.
Yes.
And second of all, did I hear you say you're not going to build any kind of a structure there?
That's correct.
Now, did I hear you say you're not planning on doing that now, or you're not doing it ever?
There is no plan for it.
And
we haven't requested that at all.
Okay.
Are you thinking maybe there should be some buffer between that lot number in the parking area? I don't know that I worry about that much as large as these are. And when that person goes to buy that, they'll be able to see what the parking lot is, and I'm sure they'll make their own concessions with them.
Well, I'm more worried about if there was a building and lights and people hanging around the building and stuff.
And certainly once that part, you know, it's like you go into a pool tennis neighborhood, and you've got the pool right there. We don't put that on them. They do that themselves. And the person buying that lot certainly recognizes that's there, and they usually work that out with the developer building themselves. I don't know if we need to get back.
Yeah, but usually when there's a pool there, all the neighbors belong to the home or the subdivision.
Well, that's what this is going to do, 12 lots, 12 slips.
This is 10 is your lot, 10 and 11 are your lots?
They live on 11. They have a house on 11 and 11, so they plan on
just... No, nobody lives on 11, that's where the boat ramp is.
There's no boat ramp now. Just to be clear, there's only a pathway down to
the
walk.
That's right.
Yes, sir.
Is there the folks that own this land live there? Right? The folks that own the land that are wanting to do this, where do they live? Lot 11?
They do it? Yes, sir.
They live on Lot 11?
Yes, sir. So it's been the family, that's the family home been there.
And that's also where the parking's going to be, so they're.
It's on their own. The access is on their own lot. They propose it on their own lot.
Like your idea, Mr. Jones, if it was off this old and looking out.
It's good enough. I think they can. Mm-hmm. Believe that's possible.
I'm certainly willing to. Mr. Chairman, I'd just like to say in response to what Mr. Rochester said, right? We can barely see the lake from our house when there's leaves on the trees. Our house is much closer to the lake than a house will be on this lot number 8. And so we don't feel requesting a buffer would deny them the lake view, and not deny them lake access, because they're not going to have access to the lake from there anyway.
There may be some concessions that you guys can come up with, though. Perhaps if they're willing to move the proposed home site further away from the property line, maybe you'd be willing to say, you know, that's okay. The further they move the house, maybe you're not so concerned, except for runoff issues. Maybe the closer they want to keep the proposed building site to the property line, the more buffer you would like. So I think that somehow, between moving the site 50 or 100 feet, it's just like moving it from here to there. It's not that big a deal, but it does give you some grass. The closer they want to your property, maybe the more buffer you would like. The further away, the less buffer you would be worried about. So.
As I said, I'm certainly willing to work with them. Just so you know, we tried to communicate this to them several times before. We invited them to come out and look at it with us and discuss it. And
this is a good opportunity for you to try it out. It's a good opportunity.
Now. I have great hopes that you guys will work it out here in the next few minutes.
More than willing to try.
Why don't we, Commissioner Tam, you've been, I hate to put you on the spot, put 10 minutes, 15 minutes. Because we're going to be going.
Just another argument.
final bell ring back? I believe you can close it and reopen.
Motion.
We have a motion. We have a second. There's no discussion. We'll vote on the motion. And that passes 4-0 with Commissioner Hamlis being absent. We are now looking at item 10, which has been postponed, I believe. Item 11, ZA 3596.
Yes, let me application 3596 for second county board of commissioners. This is located in commission district number 4. The applicant is requested to rezone 0.0 acres owned by Jeff Ross, A1 to NS. The property is located at 520 Mad Highway near the intersection with Bannister Road. Some very basic background on this one. This is an item I brought to the board of commissioners during the work session and asked for their consideration. The property owner received a zoning verification letter from the Department of Planning and Development back in the 90s. In researching that letter, drafted in the 90s, there were some inconsistencies in it. The property was later zoned in 2000 when the county went to a digital zoning map. And based on that letter the property owner received in the 90s, he would have assumed his property potentially would not have changed back in 2000 when it went to a digital zoning map. Thought based on those appeared inconsistencies in the letter, it was justified to bring to your attention and ask if you would consider initiating this county application and ask you approval to do so. Thank you.
Thank you. Chair will entertain a motion open the public hearing.
So
we have a motion to second. If there's no further discussion, please vote on the motion, which passes 4-0. Commissioner Ames being absent. Is there anyone wishing to speak in favor of this DA 3596? Is there anyone who wishes to speak in opposition to it? Seeing none, if there's no discussion, please. Actually, do I hear a motion to close the public hearing?
Second.
We have a motion to second. If there's no discussion, please vote on the motion. Which passes 4-0. Commissioner Amos being absent. Anybody wish to make a motion just before Commissioner?
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I make a motion that we approve the rezoning of property owned by Jeff Cross, ZA 3596 of A1 to the neighborhood shopping, map 119, parcel of 14, as presented.
Second.
We have a motion and a second. If there's no further discussion, please vote on the motion, which passes 4-0. Commissioner Ramos being absent. There is no old business on my agenda. We're on to new business, county attorney. Oh no, we postponed that. My mistake again. We're on to the administrative hearings. Do we want to start with these or do we want to see if they've made any headway?
I'll check. They would come back to us.
These are administrative hearings in reference to violations of the alcohol ordinance. They are not public hearings. The people who would come up and speak to us would be the people involved in the possible infraction. I'm just kind of looking at them. We've got quite a few of these. The first one is in reference to Thunderbird Lanes or Casey M. Canoes. Is there a motion to open the administrative hearing?
Chair, how do we postpone that?
Oh, it is. Okay.
In the past, that was A.I. So January 5th,
July.
Well, let's see.
I'm sure they love January.
Yeah. So 1AI is postponed. Item B, I believe, is not postponed.
Yes, Mr. Chairman, members of the board, item B I'll start off with a summary of the application for you. This is for public administrative hearing related to Corcoran Barrel. This is Corcoran Barrel, located in Commission District Number 4. This is an administrative hearing in reference to violations of alcohol ordinance for Corcoran Barrel Inc. doing business as Corcoran Barrel at 5525 Bannister Road and named in business Austin Brent. This hearing is for the employee who was issued a citation for underage sales. The employee has no prior citations and a certified letter was received by the employee. At that point, I would ask that you open the administrative hearing.
Thank you. Is there a motion to open the administrative hearing?
Second.
We have a motion to second. If there's no discussion, please vote on the motion. And that passes 4-0 with Commissioner Amos being absent. Let's see. Shall we start with the deputy, perhaps, if you have anything else? Maybe either one.
Usually this, well, actually, if you're in court, you stay with their case first.
Can you come on forward and give us just a brief synopsis?
Deputy Allen Seabolt from South County Sheriff's Department, Special Services Division. Nothing more to add on it other than he did, did check the identification and evidently made a mistake and sold the alcohol to an underage female.
Is Mr. Wehunt here? Would you care to come down and tell us your side of it, please?
Austin Wehunt, 22. I'd just like to say that it was a one-time mistake that was remedied. I wish leniency on Corcoran Barrel Inc. And I take full responsibility for it. And I would also like to add that I am now certified in alcohol, pursuing a career in the culinary field. So I take this very seriously, and that's all. Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Are you still working there, sir?
No, sir.
Are you working anywhere in the county that serves alcohol, and do you still own your property?
I believe I surrendered my permit, and no, I do not work anywhere that serves alcohol.
Thank you.
Do you understand that you were filling in while your brother was on vacation, or you were part-time to help out?
I was working part-time there to help.
And you said you surrendered your permit already?
I believe I gave it to Hunter.
You surrendered it to your brother?
Yes.
All right, thank you.
Is there a motion? More questions or a motion to close the administrative hearing?
Motion to close the hearing.
Second. We have a motion and a second. If there's no further discussion, please vote on the motion. That passes 4-0 with Commissioner Angus being absent.
Mr. Chairman, I think what is appropriate here is this first violation, the minimum suspension of his permit is for 30 days. He's already taken the safe serving, so I would just make a motion we suspend the license for a period of 30 days. Starting today.
When did he turn it in?
He said he surrendered it.
He surrendered it to the brother, to the boss, to the boss's account.
This next 30 days, you're not working anywhere which can affect your job, correct? So I would recommend you just go ahead and do it.
Start from today for 30 days.
We have a motion?
Second.
We have a motion and a second. If there's no further discussion, please vote on the motion. And that passes 4-0. Commissioner is absent. Item C is postponed.
This is for the same outlet, Corcoran Barrel Inc. doing business as Corcoran Barrel, located in Commission District Number 4. The administrative hearing is in reference to violations of the alcohol ordinance for Corporate Barrel Inc. doing business Corporate Barrel at 5525 Banister Road. The name licensee is Hunter Wehunt. This hearing is for the name licensee, and in this case, the citation was issued to the employee. The administrative hearing was just completed. The outlet has no prior citations in the last 2 years, and the return receipt mailing was received by the licensee.
Thank you. So motion to open the administrative hearing.
So moved. Second.
We have a motion and a second. If there's no discussion, please vote on the motion, which passes 4-0. Commissioner Rankin being absent. Officer, if it's okay with you, unless you feel there's something you want to add now to this, maybe in the interest of time, we'll just go to the licensee, unless you have a problem with that.
So no, okay. As is.
Okay. Is Hunter Wehunt here? If you'll come down and tell us how you view this, please.
My name is Hunter Wehunt. Thank you for giving me an opportunity to kind of plead my case. It was, as you heard, a one-time incident. Effective that night, he did surrender his license to me, which upon the spot check a couple weeks later, I gave to the deputy, so it is in, it's no longer in the store. He's no longer an employee of the store. There was a few things that I did to hopefully prevent and deter underage people coming to the store, such as I had a hand-painted sign approximately 2 feet by a foot and a half at the top of my front door and the only entrance to the store that says absolutely no one under 21 permitted. I just wanted to stress that we can take this seriously, and it was an isolated incident, and will not happen.
So you're preventing anybody under the age of 21 to come in?
Yes, sir.
Coming more than the store?
Yes, sir. It just it eliminates the problem with the front door.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
If there are no further questions, I actually have a question, officer. When he surrendered that to you, what does that mean to you, and what do you do with it?
I turn him back into our clerk, which does all of our histories, and I believe in turn she puts him with his file in our office, and then notifies Mr. Brown that we got it.
Tom, just to, you know, just kind of a detail, but functionally, isn't that the same thing as it being no longer valid?
Well, at that outlet, he would not have had the ability to sell alcohol. And I don't know if he has any, it doesn't sound like he held any other IDs at other outlets. But
you're saying he might have held others and he could have.
Could have. I wouldn't consider it. He was no longer a valid seller of alcohol in this county. I can't say it's the same thing as a suspension.
Okay. And what do they, does the law require you to take those, and what happens if they don't surrender them to you?
Well, what we'll do, whenever we do our spot checks, we go back and collect the old permits that, whenever they're not working there anymore, we collect those. If not, they'll, somebody else might try to forward one or whatnot, we just keep them and attach them back to the file in our office.
But what if they forgot to bring it in the day that this happens?
We don't.
Okay.
We don't buy.
So it's not a certainty
that you'll bring it back in.
It's not a certainty that you'll pick one of these up.
Correct.
Okay. Thanks. Is there a motion to close the administrative hearing?
So moved.
Second. We have a motion and a second. If there's no discussion, please vote on the motion, which passes 4-0. Mr. Raymond being absent. District 4.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. This particular issue was interesting to me when I read it, that I believe sometimes the family has a better mechanism to make a deal with this. There's been no priors, and I would recommend that we put a warning letter in the file that they handle it quite well.
Second motion.
We have a motion and a second. If there's no further discussion, please vote on the motion. And that passes 4-0 with Commissioner Amos being absent.
Then you do know if you come back within 24 months, there's a mandatory suspension period.
Okay, item C is postponed. And so I guess it's
Can we check out C-I? We have, yeah, C-I-I is postponed.
C-I.
And C-I, the administrative hearing for Laura Stallings. I can begin that. It is administrative hearing. This is located in Commission District Number 3. It is an administrative hearing in reference to violation of alcohol ordinance for Help or Time Midway Inc. Doing business as Help or Time Mexican Restaurant Number 13 at 4902 Atlanta Highway. The name of the employee is Laura Stallings. This hearing is for the employee, as mentioned in the description. A citation was issued to Laura Stallings for underage sales. The employee has no prior citations in the last 2 years, and a letter, return receipt letter, was received.
Thank you very much. Is there a motion to open the administrative hearing?
So moved.
Second.
We have a motion and a second. If there's no discussion, please vote on the motion, which passes 4-0. Commissioner Amos being absent. Before we start, are you okay with the information we have at this time?
Yes.
And are you Laura Stallings?
Okay. Good evening, Chairman, Commissioners. My name is Giovanni Diaz. I'm here on behalf of Ms. Stallings. Back in 2010, I'm not going to talk about the facts of the case or anything, but just to kind of give a background. I'm sure you all understand the situation and know what happened. But back in 2010, Ms. Stallings was cited for assaulting an alcoholic minor. Ms. Stallings pled guilty, I think, back in 2011 in county court. She paid a fine, and we're not here to contest what happened. Ms. Stallings accepts full responsibility for what happened. And we're here to ask that this commission show some leniency. Ms. Stallings made a mistake, and she paid for it. She has continued to work as a server and has had no incidents at all. In fact, Ms. Stallings, I don't think, has ever had any contact with any police officer or any officials ever in her life. So the incident going to court, the three times she went to court, the state court, was her first experience inside of a court, and she was very intimidated. Ms. Stallings humbly requests that the commission shows leniency and regarding the state of the license and issue of warning. In addition, Ms. Stallings lives with her husband, Henry Stallings, and her two boys. Mr. Stallings is getting close to retirement age, so she'll soon become the main breadwinner in the family. There's going to be some major changes, and we ask that this commission please take these facts into consideration. Thank you.
You must understand, even the minimum that we can do is 30 days. Yeah, the utmost leniency that minimum is 30 days on the employee.
That's where I'm a little bit confused. I thought the minimum was a warning on this first violation.
Not under age 6. You have anything to add to it, Officer Seagull?
No, I don't.
You at one time had an incident there before, and the employee was a little rough on you guys, giving you a hard time. This was not that incident, was it?
No.
Okay, thank you.
I need more time before.
Yeah, thank you.
What was the ordinance in 2010? Was it a warning at that time? Or just, does that counsel? Does that matter? Would the offense occur? It matters if we use the ordinance that was in effect at the time of the offense, or do we use the ordinance as it is in effect?
We have to use the ordinance as it is in effect now. Certainly that can play into your consideration as to what you wish to address.
Thank you.
If there's no further questions, is there a motion to close the administrative hearing?
Second.
We have a motion to second. If there's no further discussion, please vote on the motion, which passes 4-0. Commissioner Wright Amos being absent. District number 3.
And unfortunately, it is the minimum, so that's going to have to be my motion. It's going to be the minimum law allows me to show leniency. So my motion is to suspend the license of Laura Stallings for 30 days. Before I give a time frame, is there anything you prefer to start and end with?
I know that there was a period when she did leave that floor and moved to another report. Is there any way that we can consider that time period? did surrender a license to that employer, and then I don't know.
That would be litigation. I was terrible about the litigation.
Mr. Diaz, what was the amount of that she paid when she was expected?
I'm not sure. I didn't handle the case, but I think it was around $4,450. I'm not sure.
Okay.
Yes.
$150, which is actually less than what the ordinance specifies. So she had a pretty good break there of $350 on fine. The minimum fine in magistrate court is $500.
We understand the commission's hands are tied.
Is this going to affect her current employment?
In my addition. And that's why we ask this commission, if at all possible, that you would consider these facts and trying to make an exception. I know it's tough to make exceptions, and I know that being an exception is a good policy.
No, I don't think it's tough. We don't have the latitude to do so. The minimum suspension is still there.
It's in our UDC law. That's the problem. We don't have that ability to negotiate or liberally or anything like that, unfortunately.
Certainly don't want to cause her trouble with her current employer, but unfortunately it looks like that's what's by demanding a jury trial, delaying it, and pushing it out. It's just going to put it to a situation that's really beyond her control to be able to waive the entire suspension.
My question again was, is there a time in which it would be better for Ms. Stoller to start and end 30 days?
She can certainly check with her employer, and you know, we could give her till Monday afternoon to notify her director of when. And that's pretty lean. I don't know if we would suggest that.
But. I tell you what, I'll make it my motion, restate my motion, that we suspend Laura Stallings' liquor license for 30 days. She is allowed to pick the 30-day time frame and has to run consecutive. And then she's allowed to pick it sometime in the next 90 days and must give the director of that department, Tom Brown, this limited time.
And she needs to contact him on Monday.
Mr. Brown?
Yeah.
Mr. Brown. And let her know when she'll serve it within the next 90 days. Second.
Is there any chance that she has any other license that she can be using within the 90 days?
It would be, she would be required to turn in all sales IDs.
She couldn't get it.
We have a motion and a second. If there's no further discussion, please vote on the motion. And that passes 4-0 with Commissioner Ames being absent.
Chairman, Commissioner Ames, please.
The apologies for getting the benefit of the law. Keep us from the business.
I understand the position. Thank you.
And I is the one that's been postponed. Is that right?
Yes.
Okay, so we're going to number D, or DI.
Yes, the administrative hearing is located in Commission District Number 4 of the outlet, and hearing is in reference to violations of the alcohol ordinance for War Hill Investments, Inc., doing business as Norris Mini Mart at 8585 Browns Bridge Road, and the licensee is Nora Jan. This hearing is for the licensee. In this case, a citation was issued to the employee for not having the sales ID. There was one prior citation for underage sales in 2011. We heard that just in the last few months, and the outlet was issued a 30-day suspension of their alcohol license. For this citation before you tonight, the certified mailing was received by the licensee.
Thank you.
So the question. So this was for it's not having their identification, their
yes.
Selling permit, pouring permit?
Yes, an employee working at the outlet did not have a pouring permit. Pouring ID.
But it's a mini mart, so it's not a pouring permit. Yeah. They don't pour alcohol.
Sales
ID. Mm-hmm. Okay. But it wasn't underage sales.
Correct.
If it was an underage sale, the licensee didn't show up for the hearing.
Yes. Within the last few few months, we processed an underage sale, and the outlet was suspended. They could not sell alcohol from May 4th to June 2nd.
So this is for the licensee, not the employee?
Yes, for a non-underage infraction, the first infraction does not bring the employee before the Board of Commissioners. They get an automatic warning letter. So you won't see the employee in this. You'll only see the licensee, and that's because it's their second citation.
And then 4 months?
Yes.
Is there a motion to recommend the first?
So moved. Second.
We have a motion to second. If there's no further discussion, please vote on the motion. And that passes 4-0. Commissioner Raymond's being absent. Officer, are you okay with the information we have here at this time?
Yes.
Okay. Will Noor Jan, if he's here, come up, please.
Hello, my name is Noor Jan. The employee did, he was just temporarily out there to help open the store because we just opened up that location, and I was eventually going to send him up there to get a little alcohol ID. It was just temporary help, so I told him, I said, you need to go down there, I gave him the address and everything. So I went home that day, and that's what happened. The next day I came, I said, what happened? He said, well, I was going to go over there and to get my permit, but the officer came here. So he called me, he did call me on the phone. I was not in the store at that time. So he called me, so I sent him home right away. I said, look, you need to go home. And then he never showed up.
He never came back?
No, he never came back. Even if he comes back, I was not hired. So that was the story of the situation.
Did you know when you went home that evening, you were aware he did not have a permit, though?
Did I have a permit at home?
You left your employee at the store.
Yeah, no, he was like temporary. I was going to send him because we were setting up the whole thing. Like,
but you were aware he did not have a permit.
Yeah, so I told him, you need to go down there to get your permit the next day. So at the same evening, the officer came and checked for which he comes. I have another store here in there too, and by 20.
But when you went home that night, you knew that you left an employee at the store with no permit.
Yeah.
Was there any other employees there working with this employee, or were they all alone?
The person that was there with him.
And they had a permit?
He was there since he didn't have no ID, so I sent him home. I told the other guy, can you put double check? He's like, okay, I'll work since he had ID. So then the next guy asked him, I said, did you got the permit?
Let me ask you one more time to stick with this short, because when you left that night, how many employees were at your store?
Only, I mean, two.
Two. And one of them had a sales permit for selling alcohol and one did not. Is that correct?
That's correct.
Okay, thank you.
There are no further questions. Is there a motion to put the administrator?
I may have one more. I understand that you told him to go get his permit. But what were your instructions to him when you left the store and left him in the store? Did you specifically tell him not to sell any alcohol?
I did tell him, I said, do not sell any alcohol. Okay. Yes, sir.
Thank you.
Your motion to close the administrative hearing?
Second.
We have a motion to second. If there's no discussion, please vote on the motion. And that passes 4-0. Mr. Raymond is being absent.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. Mr. Brown, you know that the only two that this licensee has had?
Correct.
Okay. This is an administrative violation. Mr. Jan, is it Jan? Is that appropriate?
Yes, that's appropriate.
Yes. So I'm just going to ask that we put a warning in your file and send you a copy of it. One of the things that does concern me, though, is that you knew you left an employee at the store with no permit. You kind of willfully, you rolled the dice. You were going to leave him there and hope that nobody called him. and that happens, but I'm just going to suggest to you that if you come before me again, you're likely to see a 45 or 60 day suspension. This is not an underage sale, so it's not that big of a deal, but it continues to tell me that you selectively enforce the law when you think you may have a problem, and we're not going to do that. Okay? So my motion is to put a warning letter as well.
We have a motion and a second. If there's no further discussion, please vote on the motion. And that passes 4-0, Commissioner Amos being absent. Item E,
aye.
Tommy.
Yes, item E, aye. This is located in Commission District 1. It's an administrative hearing in reference to alcohol violations of alcohol ordinance for KIS Investments, Inc. Doing business as Quick Stop Number 1 at 2383 Cannon Highway. The name licensee is Trinidad Arjunita. The hearing is for the licensee. There were two citations issued on this day. One for prices not being listed, and a second for breaking packages. In addition to the two citations issued, the outlet also has one prior citation from 4/28/2011 for underage sales. Certified mailing was received.
Thank you. Is there a motion to open the administrative hearing?
So moved. Second.
We have a motion and a second. If there's no further discussion, please vote on the motion, which passes 4-0. Commissioner Amos being absent. Officer, are you okay with things as they are now?
Aye.
For us, as we the information we have so far. Okay. Is Srinivas Varaganti here? Please come down and tell us your side of the story.
We got a new guy on that day, just 2 days back. We explained him how to fill up the cooler, but he's a Mexican guy, so we told him not to take the 4 packs or 6 packs and put in the room. But we didn't sell anything. We didn't sell anything because the guy who was working on the counter knew that we cannot sell the singles. So he put it, and when I got a call, I just ran out to the store and checked that it was we took out and we came back. And from that day onwards, we are checking, like, you know, the package is open, and we are seeing that the prices are there. Prices they are keeping, the vendors are keeping, but, you know, the customers come in, sometimes they, when they are taking the packs, the price sticker is coming down or cutting down, and they are keeping again back. So prices thing are taking care every day. And we don't have any single bottle sales, single can sales in the store.
Are there any, further questions?
Is he addressed the price of the package? Addressed the breaking of the packages?
Well, he said that the employee broke in because he misunderstood, I guess, the instructions. And I guess, officer, do you have anything you want to say about that?
No,
according to the report, there was 12-ounce can Heineken in the cooler for sale as singles. So, and there was no prices at all in the cooler.
And do you think that's the employee's fault, or do you think the person who's supposed to run the store should?
The employer, the licensee's in charge, but I'll even go along with that. As part of our sales permits, the pricing, the labeling.
And that's the way the law reads, correct?
Great.
Thank you.
Was it one item that lost the price tag or everything?
for a lot. Like, we have some prizes, but some prizes we don't. We have six packs, and then take out from the cooler, the tap comes out and fills down, and we keep it again and fill down again.
So you don't have any little tags that go in front of the shop that are certain price?
Some places we have something that's very down, and the vendors, the type of people.
Didn't you see, what would you say, the whole area of the intersection didn't have any pricing?
According to the report, there was none of the alcohol price. The deputy that went out there was Deputy Haney, and quote, as none of the alcohol had prices posted on the shelves or on the items.
You want to try it again?
We have some, like, everything is not priced, but we have some priced, some prices up and down. Like, if it is a whole shelf is for door pack, we'll put one, not on every line. So some fell down and some are not there, some are there.
Well, what have you done to correct that?
We requested all the vendors to put the tags. Yeah, we are trying, like, every time they come, we are checking. If they are not there, we are asking them.
And they don't fall down anymore?
Some are filling down and then keeping them back. You know, the shelves are very old, like, not the new cooler, it's a old cooler. So we are trying to keep them back when we see them.
Are there any further questions for either the officer or the gentleman? If not, is there a motion to close the administrative hearing?
So moved.
Second. We have a motion and a second. There's no discussion. Please vote on the motion. And that passes 4-0. Commissioner Amos, eating absent, District 1.
Counselor, does this, when there's two violations of the same name, does it count as one or two? Would you say?
Can provide some assistance for a moment.
Tom, can you
read through that? This says the wording in the ordinance is the second violation within a consecutive 24-month period shall result in license suspension for a period of not less than 30 days, nor more than 90 days. Now, following subsection does provide the Board of Commissioners the opportunity to mitigate that. My reading is this is two citations, yes.
Two citations, one occurred at whatever time it was, and the second violation occurred simultaneously, but it's two, but we can mitigate it on administrative. Is that correct?
Well, now that we've had the hearing, would you not want to maybe wait until the district commissioner is here if I can make his recommendation?
I think Rule B comes into play without here that the commissioner can now write and see what he's supposed to handle it.
I think that I spoke to Commissioner Ames before he left. Okay. I won't say we talked about this in great detail, but I asked him if there's anything special about this administrative hearing, and he said, no, you don't go ahead and handle it. So since you're closest to him sitting down there, I think that Commissioner Levin is correct that it would be good to handle it.
We're sure in a second.
I move that we move then we postpone to the next Board of Commissioners meeting about the district commissioner.
I would just suggest a warning.
Okay.
Make a motion to put a warning in the file.
May I hear a second?
I think we might want to explain what happens.
We just took two at a time.
But did we get a second to that motion?
A second.
Thank you. Discussion?
Yeah, before we go, Tom, would you please share what will happen since this is two, even if we give a warning of being that generous and that kind?
The third citation would be potentially 90 days to 6 months of suspension.
I think it's important. Maybe you take some time to get your labeling situation in order and maybe find a way to get them labeled properly, make sure the employees are educated on breaking and labeling and all of those things, because if you come out, you've already had an underage sale this year. Now you've had two more administrative violations this year. I don't think anybody on this board wants to be.
I heard that already, who like was working at that time, frustrating the coolers. I haven't been that cool and everything.
Okay, I'm just saying, you're the owner of the store, by the manager. Yeah, go in there and make sure it's all straight, because we don't want to be hard on you. We don't want you to lose business, but you will lose business if you come back again.
We have a motion and a second, do we not, to close the administrative hearing?
No, I think we got, maybe.
Oh, I'm sorry, it was on the morning.
Yeah.
We do have a motion and a second on that.
Is that right, Mr. Daniel?
Yep.
Sonia, did you get the motion?
I have placed a warning letter with Bob.
Okay. We have a motion and a second. If there's no further discussion, please vote on the motion. And that passes 4-0. Commissioner Amos, being absent. All right. Administrative hearing number 2 has been postponed, which I think brings us back to our zoning. And we've stepped right out. We need to reopen the public hearing because I think we closed it before to find out whether they've come to some sort of agreement. Is there a motion to reopen the public hearing for the scheduled plat?
Is that item number 9?
Item number 9.
So that's SP
110004.
Motion to open the public hearing. Second.
We have a motion and a second. If there's no further discussion, please vote on the motion. And that passes 4-0. Commissioner Haynes being absent. How have you fared, gentlemen?
Mr. Chairman, members of the commission, I think that was time well spent. So we have worked with our neighbors. I think on lot number 8, we have come to a resolve that we feel like is a good solution for everybody involved. We have agreed that on lot number 8, the rear setback will be a 25-foot building setback on lot 8. There will be a 20.
There's already a 50-foot setback on it now.
Yeah, it'll be, what did I say?
25.
Oh, I'm sorry, we're increasing by 20. It'll be a 75-foot, I apologize. It'll be a 75-foot building setback on the lot. And there will be a 25-foot buffer on that. And we went through some criteria that we all came to an agreement of what could be done. So I'm about to make Mr. Brown's job a nightmare, but I think we came to some ideas of how we can do that and give them some criteria of whether it's being done properly or not. But what we've agreed, inside that 25-foot buffer, there shall be no grading that takes place in there. There shall be no heavy equipment, meaning, i.e., anything bigger than a lawn tractor. There should be anything bigger than a lawnmower or a small lawn tractor that can go in there. No cutting of trees 6 inches in diameter or larger. They shall be allowed to do managing underbrush, selectively managing underbrush without grading. And limbing of trees shall be allowed within that 25-foot buffer up to the main entry level of the house. So we were trying to set some kind of level of where that could be done.
The floor level of the main entry?
The main, right. If it's a basement, but you enter the main level, it would be the main level. It wouldn't be the second story of the house, but it wouldn't be the basement either. It would be the main entry level of the house.
I would love to be able to put an actual foot on that. It would be a lot easier for them to govern down the road.
We did talk about that.
Yeah, typically you have a non-foot basement plus your band and your slab that's out of the ground. You're probably about 12 feet. Do you want to get 12 feet, 15 feet?
It would be up to the height where if you're on the main level of the house, you could. So I would say it would be more like 20 feet.
You want the ceiling of the second level.
The ceiling of the main level. Because I'm being real careful, clearly, because somehow people out there interpret basements 20 years from now when they're trying to go back in there.
That's why it's better to go sometime. Feet.
Right.
Let's just pick a feet level.
But that's up to from the elevation of the house, though. Because the problem we talked about in that is the land slopes down it's not going to be at tree level, that's going to be at the house level.
I think what you're saying is you could be up to 30 to 40 feet up in the tree cutting limbs.
Possibly, yes, sir. But only limb. They're not allowed to cut the trees, so that's why we came to a diameter less of what can be cut, no grading.
I don't think I've ever seen that done before. Just like a bunch of really tall sticks.
I'm not worried about that. I'm just looking out to. Tom, do you have a little help at the team?
It actually doesn't lie around the lake. The Corps of Engineers, unfortunately, a lot of times it happens actually, the Corps gets involved on their property of the lake, too.
We don't have the staff internally to document that. Short of having surveyors who will shoot those lines, I can't
be up to, I would think, whoever is making the complaint to bring in the documentation that shows there's violations, because they have to hire surveyors or whatever. And I think the county's not going to do that.
I realize what you're after, but also your lake is at a grade that's much lower than you, so it's not like you need to see some of the plateau of your second floor straight across everywhere. To be cutting limbs of 30, 40 feet in the air is going to be really strange looking. Most of those trims that you're talking about, I've seen them are 15, 20 feet up because the lake's down below and you're looking down toward the lake.
I think that if you document the language appropriately, there's a way to measure it. And it's up to the person that feels that there's a violation, and it's one of you or your neighbors, that you would have to document that somehow and bring it in and unless there's a violation. I'm okay with that. It really puts it to where if you feel there's that monkey business going on, you can
absolutely
comply with the
plan. And that brings up a very good point. I would like to ask if you would clarify for them, because I told them I would ask a clarifying question, because they had a concern that if 10 years from now this lot sells, somebody comes in there and just wipes out this buffer. I told them that under the county ordinance, they would actually be required to that buffer would have to be replanted. And I don't know if that needs to be in the condition or not, but we're fine with that. We just want to make sure that if they clear cut it without permission, that would have to be replanted. That buffer would have to be revegetated.
Could that covenant be recorded with the deed so it's a courthouse?
Yes, both questions is my answer.
I think here's what my preference would be if I were representing them, is I would rather it be a condition of zoning, because if it's a covenant, then they have to pay to go and enforce it. So I would prefer, if I was sitting in their shoes, and they have been very helpful outside, and we work really well together, so I would ask that be a condition of zoning so they don't have to bear the burden of enforcing this.
Good. Well, what I'm concerned about, we could do both, because there's no cost to reporting this part of the game.
Oh,
that somebody in the future, 20 years down the road, that they have the opportunity to understand that. So let's have both of them. Let's have both in both ways.
That's fine.
I would suggest on the no cutting of trees 6-inch diameter or larger, we would tweak that just to say 6-inch diameter breast height. That's a more specific
term. We're fine.
We don't have to measure that exactly.
That's fine.
I appreciate y'all taking the time with that. Is that comfortable? Very, very pleased with that.
I think we were pleased in the way we worked together, and we're happy with it now. And we're obviously 25 feet farther back, building setback. Since we don't deal with this every day, I would ask you gentlemen and Director Brown, maybe if you think this adequately protects our property. You think this is an adequate compromise? Since we don't know the code, we don't deal with this every day.
I personally think this is a good deal. That's my personal opinion. And that you should take it.
Yes.
That's my opinion.
In light of there could be 70 lots there as well, and I know that.
Well, if these lots were not as large as they were, it'd be a whole different story. But these are very, very big lots. And I think that it's probably going to be nice homes. I can't imagine putting anything less than what would be attractive, because the lots in their own way are going to be.
We were always pleased with that and didn't want to fight the whole plan.
I think this is a good compromise. I would just add that if Mr. Brown feels it's some point that we're, that when this is done, that it really is confusing about what ends up becoming the language of the limiting, that you would just maybe let Commissioner Ball, Chairman Ball know, he can make a decision on the vote. How do you want to do it?
And certainly if they get really out of control of tripping all these trees out and really cutting, and you've always got the option to put your own barrier up on your property.
Yeah, I have a bunch of those.
So, I mean, as long as we're along, I wouldn't do that, but if they ever get to where they're, you know, as open to wide open on you, you're having a hard time, you've always got the option of playing your own buffer.
Mr. Chairman, if I could ask, a lot of time was taken up on this one lot issue, and we sort of broke up the time, and there wasn't rebuttal time and all that, and I'm not sure whether our neighbors had some other, if there was time left, if they had some other concerns that they still wanted to address, is that possible?
Well, first of all, before we get to that, are there any other items?
I think there were two other items that we needed to address that were open-ended that we wanted to try to call through.
Let's work through those, and because in all fairness, no one stepped forward at the beginning of this and said, so let's see how much time it takes to get through this.
Yes, sir. What we proposed, there were some questions about minimum square footage. We talked to our client. You felt like there's probably only one house that even surrounds this is 2,500 square feet or larger. What we thought was an appropriate level, and I'll explain why, is we would like that set at 2,000 square feet. And the reason that we feel that way is this very potentially could be empty nesters that are coming in there. Quite frankly, they are not interested in, bigger is not necessarily better. They may want something smaller, but a very high dollar square foot. So we would like to ask that square footage be set at 2,000 square feet.
And I would, that's up to you, Jim.
Where's the gentleman? How do you feel about that?
Yeah. First of all, my house is 3,600 square feet heated. I don't like
that. Right.
So, and there's like four houses, at least larger.
Could you come forward?
We pulled some of the data on that, so it must have been some data wrong on that. But.
Do we need to agree to extend this?
Thank you.
2 more minutes.
Well, 2 more minutes without exception. Okay, go ahead.
All I'm asking for is I've mentioned that we have houses larger than 2,500 square feet meted, and as an amendment that's going to be added to this
Okay, if you had a choice between 1,000 and 2,000, which would you choose?
What's the rest of the square footage requirement off the top of your head? Do you know?
Sorry. Much more than 1,000 square feet. Race 3. 1,250 square feet.
What is it, 1,250?
1,250.
That's for res 3.
What is it?
1,250.
It's currently 1,100 according to
the... Yeah,
he has to be res 3.
Yes,
it's R2R, which is
1,100. R2R is easy.
Is this 2,000 square feet heated square feet?
Yes, sir. 2,000 square feet of heated finished square footage.
You're willing to put that condition?
Yes, sir.
And what was the other item?
They have one more.
This was a clarification on something that was shown earlier tonight that we weren't aware of.
Yeah, on the staff report, there was no clear conditions, and I noticed that when we first started our presentation, there was two conditions. Can we bring this back up? And I have a question about number two. Can we get clarification to the intent of that condition?
Number one there on order two?
No, engineer under engineering condition number two.
It's pretty standard condition we see coming out of the engineering department on just about anything that comes before the board. They're basically putting the applicant on notice that they're going to have the construction improvements that they're going to require for the properties developed.
Could be storm drain, man.
Storm drain, could be a line of sight issue.
Yeah, and we're fine with that. I think our bigger concern is if they want one driveway for all 13 lots would be, you know, and I mean, we definitely don't want to put driveways where they're not safe.
I don't think that's the intent of it.
Okay. We just wanted to clarify that. And that's all we have, Mr. Chairman.
And then I would like to see if we can grant some more time to hear. No, does anybody else who lives there want to say anything more about this? Okay. Then I would like to make a motion that we approve this request, SP 11. Second. We have a motion and a second. If there's no further discussion, please vote on the motion. That passes 4-0. Commissioner Rankin's absent. I would like to make the motion that we approve SP 110004 with the conditions that the houses be a minimum of 2,000 heated square feet. Tom, were you able to catch can you capture for me the 6-inch cutting?
The entire condition or that one section?
The entire condition.
I heard the on the rear of the property there would be a buffer
of number 8
feet
of lot 8.
Of lot 8, thank you. Within that area, no grading, no heavy equipment, no cutting of trees, a diameter breast height of 6 inches or larger. They are allowed to manage underbrush. They are allowed to conduct activities involving limbing of trees up to the main level of the house. And then that was further clarified to say the ceiling of the main level projected outwards.
Okay, and can you go over again the setback? What you said about the setback? I believe it's the rear setback of 75 feet and the 25 foot buffer?
Yes, 75 feet.
Okay. And I would make that my motion.
Second.
That those be conditions. Before you second it, I think there was also a component of putting it in the deed as well.
Yeah, that we recorded as a condition. It's not really a zoning, it's a sketch plan condition. Zoning condition was appropriate.
This is a sketch plan.
And that it also be recorded in the deed on number 8. I would just clarify that when you sell it, you don't need to do that. When you sell the property, you stick it on the.
And it be included as a deed on number 8. And that is my motion.
And I'll second.
We have a motion and a second. If there's no further discussion, we vote on the motion. And that passes 4-0. Commissioner Ames being absent.
Thank you.
Thank you. Counselor, is there a need for an executive session? Counselor?
No need for executive session.
Is there any other business to come before this board? No. Seeing none, is there a motion to adjourn?
Thank you.
Is there a motion in a second?
May I interrupt just a second? You did not take action on what's on the screen on this last.
Just need to add that.
Do I need to make all that in one motion, or can I add this? As it relates to, just a second, let me get the number right. As it relates to SP, that's not right either.
Oh, we need to withdraw the motion.
Yeah.
Got a motion and a second to adjourn?
We'll just postpone, withdraw the motion, please.
Chair with me, please. If this is okay, then I would like to add a motion to SB 110004 that it's approved with the conditions as displayed, as well as the previous conditions.
Second.
We have a motion and a second. If there's no further discussion, please vote on the motion. And that passes 4-0 with Commissioner Amos being absent. And now, is there a motion to adjourn?
Second.
We have a second.
Second.
We have a motion and a second. If there's no further discussion, please vote on the motion. That passes 4-0 with Commissioner Amos being absent. And we are adjourned at 7:49 p.m. You're happy.
Thank you.